So, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to be here to address this important topic with you. I think my distinguished co-panelists have covered a lot of ground already. I'm quite sure you are eager to move to the interactive part of the debate. And so what I will try to do is entertain you with a bigger picture in which I will, which I think is composed of, I will use images like tsunamis, volcanoes, and also coastal villages. I might even touch on a Titanic. And if you allow me to stay into the sea-related metaphors, paying my tribute to the well-known cult of liquidity, I will even make the volcano an underwater volcano. And if I have time within the 10 minutes that are allocated, I'll even tell you two very short stories at the end. So, now going to the big picture, first of all, I think it's clear, but I will repeat this, we think the Commission proposal is both reasonable and balanced. A lot of people in the academic world, in civil society, and including some policymakers such as the OECD, would have liked to see something much stronger that goes much further with much less discretion for supervisors. Of course, at the other side of the spectrum, for very good reasons, you know, bankers would be keen to remove the proposal and of course, would be very, very keen to you know, keep the implicit subsidy that is essential to the business model. So I think in the middle we have this proposal, which we think again is balanced and reasonable. Now I think also in the big picture, I think the way we see the whole Juncker's agenda, which is the mandate for the new newly elected European Parliament as well, the mandate for these new European institutions. There are two sides to it. Indeed, there's the growth and jobs agenda, which is crucial for obvious reasons. And then on the other side, there's, I think, a major challenge, even if it's not so explicit, which is to address the democratic deficit and an increasing gap between the thinking of European elites and national elites and in European citizens in general. I think these are, of course, extremely interrelated. So, you know, if you don't create growth and jobs, you will not restore confidence in EU institutions. But also, I think on the stability perspective, the confidence of consumers, you know, it's key that we, you know, they understand we have taken the proper steps following the financial crisis. If they have any feeling that the proper steps have not been taken, I think this will go a long way in maintaining a lack of confidence. Now, I think this proposal actually addresses both and plays on both issues. I think, and I will discuss this in a minute, I think the banking structure reform proposal is crucial for the safety of the financial system. On one side, and on the other side, I think it's crucial for its social usefulness, as has been mentioned, you know, to basically make it support the growth and jobs agenda. So on the first element, which is safety, basically our point of view is that banking union is a great step forward for small and medium-sized banks. So for many reasons, I'm not going to extend on this. It's a great effort. It sets the basis for a much tighter and efficient supervision at European level that works for small and medium-sized banks. We believe, and it's the case of again a number of experts, that it's not going to work for the too big to fail banks, for several reasons I will explain. Now I come.
Benoit, small banks are exempt from European supervision.
No, indeed. But what I mean and what I'm going to come to a second. Is that we're not really worried that with the package of European reform that has been passed for the last 5 years, we think indeed for small and medium-sized banks, and that goes beyond, of course, banking union, the system is going to work, and you could almost say, yeah, the job has been done. We wouldn't go that far. You can always improve, but that's for banking union and other measures. Now, I think coming to this tsunami, I have to say in Brussels, usually when you hear about this tsunami, you're not talking about the tsunami of unemployment. You're not talking about tsunami of people going below the rate of poverty. You're not talking about the tsunami of public money that was necessary to save the banks. Most of the time, you're talking about the tsunami of banking regulation and banking reform. So I'm afraid there's a big disconnect there between the way we see things in Brussels and the way European citizens see that. So I'm afraid in 2008, we had a tsunami of banking losses, as we all know. And then in a metaphor, the coastal villages, which represent citizens, have taken the hit because you didn't have the proper embankments in place to make sure this tsunami would not hit coastal villages, which is you wouldn't need public money to stop these waves of losses. Now, the G20 response to that, and that relates to banking union, is to create or strengthen the three key embankments. The first one, of course, is capital requirements. So the first buffer to stop the wave should be own capital. Now, we know that there are you know, some flaws related to that. The first one is the, I mean, both related, in fact, to the risk-weighted assets system. You know, as a reminder, Dexia, a few months before it collapsed, had 11% of Tier 1 capital ratio. So that shows you that, you know, there is a problem with this specific indicator. Secondly, as the Basel Committee realizes, having done tests, the way the banks calculate, you know, the way the internal models function lead them to very different assessments in terms of the size of capital they need. So that's the first embankment. The second one is creditors. So that's the whole bail-in mechanism. I think, again, very useful. We see two major weaknesses. The first one is actually the pool of assets that's going to be bail-inable. So the definition of these assets and the exemptions from the bail-inable securities. And the second one is, of course, the interconnectedness of the system. And again, that goes for much more for the too-big-to-fail banks. It's all good to be able to perform bail-in, but the supervisor will obviously think twice or even more if this is going to have a domino effect with the role of wholesale funding between very large institutions that might trigger, again, a reaction effect. The third embankment is, of course, the single resolution funds, and we will see, again, extremely useful, but you know, I'm afraid the size of it, so 55 billion over a few years, is again, very useful for some of the medium-sized institutions, but that for the very large institutions, this amount might not be sufficient if the first two embankments have not been properly activated. So the thing is, we think the G20 agenda missed dramatically the banking structure reform proposal. Now I come to these underwater volcanoes. For us, you know, if you have these volcanoes that actually trigger the eruptions and trigger the tsunamis, it's okay as long as you have small to medium-sized ones, because then the waves, basically the embankments will work for these type of waves. If you have these more, you know, too big to fail banks or, you know, giant underwater volcanoes, they will create these tsunamis, and we argue that for those, the embankments will simply not work, and again, the citizens would be hit. And we think the BSR proposal goes a long way into first making the commercial banking part much safer and moving away from the coastline and away from public money, the investment side of the bank. Now, the second element after safety that I just addressed is the usefulness, the social usefulness, or the contribution to growth and jobs. And there we think, again, the BSR proposal goes a long way. We said in an event we had in this very place 10 days ago, the event was entitled What Growth for What Jobs? So basically we see this, you know, the aim of growth and jobs and how to finance that. You could call that the journey of Commissioner Hill. I think it's a crucial journey, as I said. So financing growth is of course, key. We all agree on that. And we think, basically, I will mention three elements when you embark on such a journey that you should reflect on, because, again, this journey is crucial. It's not exactly like a honeymoon or a summer holiday journey. And so the first one, if you go back to the sea-related metaphor, would be where do you want to go? So what is the landing point? And that is really a definition of what growth you want, what is the economic and political vision you have. We think that's lacking for the moment. And the second one is about the compass and the navigation tools we have. And that is really the policy mix. So is the policy mix that you have there proper to reach that goal of financing growth and jobs? And the last one, of course, is with the type of embarkation or the type of boat you're going to choose, and that is what type of financial system or institution do you want? And again, I think that's a choice between, you know, small size, more I would say maneuverable and recoverable embarkations, or the more Titanic-like type of boats. And I think here it's important to remember that we've made choices for the last 20 years, and I think we've answered these questions. Well, actually, we didn't answer the first question, which is what growth do we want? Then the second one, in terms of policy mix, I think we need to recognize there was a strong push for these too big to fail banks, including the European institutions. They actually went for this deregulation agenda linked to a promotion of the kind of Titanic banks, to, you know, with the understanding that this would actually drive growth and be beneficial for the whole European Union. So I think that there's a big reflection to be had before we embark on including capital markets union, revival of securitization, and so on. We think the BSR proposal plays a key role in this landscape, as I said, both as regard to safety, and that goes a long way into restoring confidence of investors, consumers, and citizens in general, but also in terms of the contribution of the financial sector to jobs and growth. And I will stop there for the moment. Thank you.